aren't we? Oops.
She should be all set now, Catherine.
Oh, did you do it? Okay. Well, let me go ahead and introduce Portia. Portia Shanduka is an RN, a registered midwife with a bachelor's in nursing, and currently nursing advanced midwifery at neonatology. She's a Zimbabwean, but she's working as a nurse educator and deputy head of the midwifery program at the Pare School of Nursing in a rural district in Lesotho. She's also a counselor. She has many years of experience in clinical midwifery and as faculty member. She's interested in midwifery education and practice, sexual and reproductive health, and women and girl child issues. And she's working on a national framework for strengthening midwifery knowledge translation. She's worked with developing midwifery modules and reviews. She's an examiner of midwifery final examinations. She has developed and administered midwifery e-learning platforms, and she participates in an International Confederation of Midwives Delphi survey of the midwifery core competencies and midwifery assessment tools, as well as worked with the Lesotho Nursing Council's midwifery education and practice standards and competencies. And it's with great pleasure that I turn the mic over to Portia to discuss with us the students' use of the partogram at a district hospital in Lesotho.
Hello, everybody. Hello, everybody. Can you hear me? Hello.
Portia, you can go ahead. We can hear you very well.
Thank you. Thank you for coming to attending this presentation. It's so exciting. It's evening, it's at night on my side. My presentation is on the students' use of the partogram at a rural, at a district hospital in Lesotho. The Pare School of Nursing is the only nursing college in the rural districts. We have other nursing colleges which are in the urban or in the capital city, Maseru. So Pare School of Nursing is part of the Pare Mission Hospital. It's a mission institute. So it is Pare School of Nursing and Pare Hospital, where the study was carried out, is under one proprietary, that Catholic mission. So Pare School of Nursing is one of the nurse training institutions in Lesotho. Commenced the new curriculum, which is a competency-based curriculum in midwifery in 2014. And for Pare School of Nursing, it was the also beginning of this program. We have the other program is general nursing, which is 3 years, and the certificate nursing assistant, which is 1 year, 3 months. So in this curriculum, the competency-based curriculum is focused on the performance. It's one of the government measures of reducing maternal mortality in the country. before the new curriculum, they started increasing the recruitment of midwives through increase in intake, so as to increase the workforce and also improving the health facilities, like the rural health facilities, so that they can offer maternity services to the mothers in the rural areas, as well as the equipment and on all the facilities through the partner organizations. So, but still the maternal mortality is still an a problem, as the Millennium Development Goals in 2015, the Lesotho did not meet that target of reducing by 75%. It was actually off track. So one of the recommendations to fast track the Millennium Development Goals was to improve the workforce and the quality care, and that included the use of the partogram. So in this new curriculum, the partogram is one of the competencies in the labor module of the midwifery. So as you can see, this is the background. This black and white picture is just showing the student midwife attending to the woman in the clinical area. Most of the time, they are alone. There is a shortage of staff, and they need supervision, they need guidance, and they need to apply what they have learned in the clinical area. But most of the time, they find themselves alone, and they have to meet the outcomes according to the new curriculum. And this picture of the student with auscultating with a fetoscope, that is the resources that are available. And when you are alone and you have nobody supporting you, nobody supervising you, the clinical confidence and competence is compromised. So when you look at that picture, you see that the fetoscope is pressing deep into this pregnant abdomen. So the purpose of this study was to explore the student midwife's application of the partogram competency in the clinical setting. As I mentioned, that it is the competence in the new curriculum, it is focused on performance. So we are more concerned about the performance. So that is what the government thought of the reason of introducing the new curriculum, that they thought they could increase the duration of midwifery training, or even just increase the number of midwives. Currently, they are on compulsory midwifery. After completing 3-year training in general nursing, they have to proceed and continue with compulsory midwifery training as a specialty. Is also a measure that is quantitatively increasing the workforce, but the issue of the performance is still to be addressed. We're hoping that this curriculum of competency-based will address this issue of the knowledge, the practice, the theory practice incongruence. It is a global issue, and in Lesotho, as you can, we can appreciate that it's a low resource setting. The practice area is quite different from the faculty. And so Lesotho is also included in this issue of the clinical theory practice incongruence. So this the student in the new curriculum, the students, they leave the classroom after the theoretical capacitation and they go through simulation to practice those skills so that they transit to the clinical practice area to apply those competencies in the real, on the real patients. So, and they have to they evaluate on their evaluations of their learning, both clinical, classroom, and simulation. They expressed a challenge, especially in with regard to the use of the pathogram. So that is how the study was carried out. The focus, it was a qualitative design. Focus group interviews were done with this current intake in 2017, between October and November. So we had two focus group discussions for students of that same intake. We have one intake per year, a group of 10 each, and they were interviewed by a trained interviewer. And then the same data was triangulated. We had to ask the same questions about how students apply the pathogram competence in the clinical area. Two faculty members, a clinical instructor, and an educator, they had individual interviews. And then we had one focus group discussion, was one focus group interview of the student, of the midwives, the professional midwives who are supervising those students. And it was for the same purpose, to find out whether there are any challenges and any positive or negative experiences and any suggestions. So this is the Lesotho context. As you can see, it's a low resource setting. The topography, you can see that it's a mountainous area and it's high altitude, it's very cold. And most of the places, that is where the mothers are, they are not accessible. Even when they have to be referred to the referral center, to the town, they have to use helicopters because the places are not accessible. So that means facility beds is the only option that is available for them, because they cannot be accessible if they have to have home beds. And there's also HIV, which is also a burden, and it's affecting, in Lesotho is the highest in the age 15 to 49 years, and that is the childbearing age. It is impacting heavily on the women, and also this maternal mortality rate. And then the simulation setting, when the government introduced the new curriculum across all the training institutions, we had also supporting organizations like NAPI. They supplied the simulation equipment, so it makes it easy for students to simulate, to practice safe these skills before they get to the actual practice area. And then in the clinical area, when you get to the clinical area, you find that is the basic. In the hospital where the study was carried out, it is the labor ward actually has two beds that can be separate, that are separated by screens, these curtain screens. And then the rest of the beds are postnatal and antenatal wards, about 16. all in all. And so these are the resources that are available. Everything is manual, as you can see. Maternal observations, they are done with this manual equipment, fetal observations, vaginal examinations, abdominal examinations to palpate for the contractions, document, everything is manual, still in that context. And then, so as I said, the study took the design of exploratory, descriptive, and contextual, the qualitative design. The population is this 2018 intake of 37 student midwives. And they were purposively sampled from all key holders so as to triangulate the same data. And we used a semi-structured interview guide. Analysis was done by the researcher because I could not interview my own students myself. So I did the transcription and the analysis through open coding, and then themes from those audio taped transcripts, themes emerged. So four major themes emerged from those quotes with three categories each. The first was satisfaction with theoretical capacitation. So both the midwives and the faculty and the students themselves, they expressed that they are satisfied with the theoretical capacitation of the students in relation to the pathogram before they get to the clinical area. And then, so under this satisfactory theoretical capacitation, there were categories of the knowledge about components of the pathogram, the knowledge on how to plot and how to interpret it, and also they had positive attitude towards the pathogram because they all knew the importance and the value of the pathogram. And then the second theme on midwifery simulation, it was shown to be barely close to a reality. The students, they expressed that, yes, they have the equipment in the simulation, but most of the simulators, whether it's low fidelity or high fidelity, they really mimic the midwifery competencies. As you can and appreciate that most of the midwifery procedures involve the sense of touch. So when they palpate the contractions on a simulator, they don't get that confidence, because when they get to the clinical area, is in the real patient, is a real pregnant woman, is it feels different. Even doing the vaginal examinations on a simulator is quite different. The auscultating, the fetal heart, and so the categories that came under this theme was all those labor observations and monitoring, they are only feasible to do and plot when they are in the simulation settings. And they said they leave the simulation not fully confident and not fully competent, though they have that knowledge and the value of the pathogram. So it meant that this simulation is not bridge enough. It's supposed to be the bridge between the theory and the practice. And then there's the other theme of theory practice incongruence. This theory practice incongruence that they have been complaining about, they found that in the pathogram, when they get to the clinical area, it's a school thing. The pathogram is a student thing. It's not a labor monitoring tool. They find that it's done only for the students because the students are there. And when the midwives, they are there to supervise them is mainly to make sure that they do not overuse. Because when the midwives were interviewed, they were saying the students like the pathogram, so they end up commencing it when it's not necessary. And they said themselves, they use the pathogram when they are free or when they are not busy. So it's because most of the time they are busy, it becomes the thing for students or thing for school. And also it's application of the knowledge and attitudes that they have when they are in the clinical area. It's limited by time, material, and human resources. And then also another category under this theory practice incongruence is the clinical confidence and competence is only developed after long practice exposure. So if it's, they are hardly supervised and they hardly utilize it appropriately, so it means they will still need a long practice exposure on using the pathogram, because they've transited from through the simulation with still without full confidence. And then we had suboptimal professional role modeling. So since in the clinical area they find that the only professional practitioners who use the pathogram are the midwives, they said the doctors and other cadres, they don't use the pathogram. So now it means they depend on the professional midwives for the professional role modeling. And this professional role modeling is hampered by poor supervision. Most of the time they are not supervised, it's not satisfactory. And then they say the experiences of good birth outcomes without the use of the pathogram by professional midwives negatively influences their personal zeal and value of the pathogram. So even if, as much as they have the value when they leave the classroom, they have the value of the pathogram and the knowledge enough to apply it. But when they get to the clinical area, they find mothers are giving birth normally and they don't see complications. So they say, it means you can do without. So it now negatively influences their professional zeal and the value that they of the pathogram that they had when they left the classroom. And also that they realize that the midwives, they also need support. They are not supported because they find in the clinical area they come with the knowledge, they seem to be up to date more than their supervisors who are the professional midwives. And the professional midwives themselves, they said, we need to be updated, we need support. So, and the student midwives, they said, the midwives need to be supported, they need to have incentives, they need to be awarded, and so that they teach us. So they have the experience that relationship for proper professional role model. We need those interpersonal relationships that are sound. And some of the students, they said the midwives are not interested in teaching us, and they think they are not competent, or they think they are just too busy for them. While the midwives themselves, they say some of the students are not interested, and they said we are busy. We support them when we are not busy. So it was a matter of it depends. So they would all say it depends on some the midwives will say some students, they are motivated and we support them. And the students will say some midwives, they are interested and they support us. So it was the issue of the relationship. So the conclusion now is that the students found that they face a limitation in using the pathogram fully at the clinical learning settings. From the results or from the findings, some students, they said, when we want to, sometimes we are limited by all this time and material resources, and including the human resources, because they need to be supervised. And all in, after all this experience, some of the students, they said, even us, when we are using the pathogram now, because we are learning, because we want to learn, because it's a requirement of their curriculum. In their curriculum, they have to apply what they have learned, and they are assessed on the competencies. It's unlike in the previous curriculum where they just do their theory in class and then the practical is done, it's not integrated and is done separately. They will just learn the practical procedures but not as like the competencies. And then at the end of the year, they would have just one or two final procedures, clinical procedures for the practical assessment. But in this case, they have every module, it has at the end of the year, they have to do an OSCE of 10 stations, which cover an integrated assessment of the whole, all the competencies. So now the students were saying, we are using the pathograph because we are learning, we want to learn. So when we are qualified, we might not also use the pathogram. If we are in the same working environment, same working conditions with this, like this professional midwife, so it meant that this is a challenge, it's challenging, it's a threat to the future, because the students are the future of the midwifery profession. So I recommend that the faculties to strengthen the students' clinical learning support, starting from simulation. Now that this challenge of in the clinical setting of shortage of midwives and shortage of resources, they will always encounter a difference when they get to the clinical area. So it is imperative that this to strengthen student support of clinical learning must start at the simulation, to find ways of also of improving the midwifery simulation to be more authentic and to try and bridge the theory practice gap. And also the curricular reforms should also include the clinical area, because when the new curriculum was introduced, all the faculty in all the schools were capacitated and were accredited to and approved to commence this new curriculum. But there is not much that was done on the clinical placement settings for their readiness for the students. So they have the experience despite the shortage of resources, human resources particularly. They've experienced also a large number of groups of students who come at the same time who are an extra load to them, who need their supervision, their guidance, their coaching. And in Lesotho, there is no, we don't have that structure for clinical preceptorship and mentorship support for all clinical practitioners, be it student practitioners or professional practitioners. So we need them, the studies and including action should be collaborate between the faculty and the clinical area. So I also recommend closer collaboration with the service to support midwives who in turn support and role model the students. And improve partogram theory practice gap. So since this study is the foundation or the smaller chunk for developing that framework for midwifery knowledge translation in Lesotho. So if we also forge that closer relationship of the support of midwives, then this study, it was an eye-opener on me, because when I listened to the interviews for these midwives, I found that they also need support, yet we expect them to support our students. So the question was, who supports the midwives whom we expect to support our students? They also need guidance. There are no national guidelines for labor and maternity guidelines in the country. So the question is, who guides the midwives whom we expect to guide our students? And who role models them if they also need mentorship? Who role models them? Since we expect them to role model the students, and we expect them to coach our students, who coaches them? So these are all the questions that I came up with, and I saw that all these curriculum reforms, for them to be a success, they must also start there at the clinical area where we want the outcome. The main outcome or the main target of the government to reduce maternal mortality. If we want our mothers to benefit, we must also support the midwives who support our mothers. So now if the students, they are like the clients, they are in between the faculty and the clinical area. So if they are strained, is the study done at this institution of the professional role of the professional nurses in their clinical teaching? It revealed that they experience role strain, but they are resilient and they are solution focused. So we need to support the midwives who support our students. And at the end of the day, our mothers are supported. And then we'll all achieve the same goal of reducing maternal mortality in the country. So the partogram is the identified competency that it can be evaluated, because on just random check, you can check the utilization. Even on random observation, you can just drop in and you see how it is utilized. So it was chosen for this as a starting point for the midwifery knowledge translation. Since they were not talking about, only complaining about the partogram, but they were saying, especially the partogram is difficult to implement or to practice or to apply everything that we learn at the school when we get to the clinical area. It was mainly, the outcry was mainly of the partogram. So they say practice makes perfect, but I say provided it is perfect practice. So if I don't want my students to do as Romans do, which is imperfect practice, I have to be part and parcel of changing Rome for my students. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. I wanted, sorry to interrupt, but I do want to leave a little bit of room in case our audience has any questions.
Yes.
Are there any specific questions for Portia? Well, I just wanted to say that I think you, with your study of the partogram, I think you've identified a very important issue that all us educators and students face. You use the example of the partogram, but there are so many other examples of things we teach, and yet the students don't see it in practice, like our previous session on delayed cord clamping,
Exactly.
and all our theoretical knowledge of labor support, where we see the clinical practicing midwife running from room to room with no time. So I think, this is really something that deserves a very wide discussion. Okay, so Jane would like to know how many students you're educating a year in Lesotho. Am I Shanduka?
We have one intake per year, and it's about 40 per group.
40, okay.
Yes.
And how long is the program then?
It's 1 year.
1 year program, okay. So Sheila is asking about equipment for determining the fetal heart rate with the fetoscope. So how do midwives pick up changes in the fetal heart rate pattern, such as decelerations, which is also part of the Philpott partograph?
Exactly, they use the fetoscope. That is the basic tool that is available in all facilities. The CTG is only available at the one facility, that is the National Referral Center. That is where they get to practice or use the CTG. So it means for decelerations, accelerations, they can only pick it manually. But on the pathogram, they just plot the rate, and that's all. They just
Just the rate,
detect,
just the rate.
just
They
the
don't
rate, just
identify
to detect whether,
decelerations and accelerations.
just to detect whether it's below 120 or it's above 160. That's all.
Right. So there's a question also from Taramati Barker about the partogram. She just wants to clarify if it's used both in clinical and the classroom or only in the classroom.
It is used the in the clinical area. They use the old pathogram, not the new WHO, but it's being introduced in the classroom. So in the
Right.
classroom, they are exposed to both the new WHO modified one and the old one that still has the latent phase.
Okay, that's what I was. That was my understanding, but Ms. Barker wanted a clarification. Now, Sheila also points out in terms of fetal heart rate patterns that if you auscultate the fetal heart rate immediately after a contraction, you will hear the deceleration. So you can identify, periodic changes. And then she goes on to say, in her setting, she required the fetal heart rate to be taken before and after a contraction so that one could pick up if there was a change in the rate as the result of a contraction. And this can be done with the fetoscope. Right, I was taught to listen throughout the contraction, which can be a bit challenging with some of the moms.
Yes, for the manually, actually, you need to listen before, during, and after a contraction.
Right, that's what I
and
was
fit
taught.
the pattern.
But we have lost in the US, we have lost the skill. We really have lost the skill of auscultation in so many settings. Because it's something that needs to be practiced. Yeah, and Linda agrees that sometimes it's uncomfortable for the mom during a contraction.
It is.
Portia, is your study ongoing or is it completed now?
This first part is the one that is complete,
Okay.
but then the next phase is now to try to develop the framework or the guidelines for the starting with the labor documentation, labor guidelines, because that is what the midwife saying. They don't have anything to refer to. You just have to ask their colleagues for consult,
Right.
to just to consult a colleague, but they are also not sure.
Okay. Well, that sounds good. Please keep us up to date on your work. We really appreciated hearing from you.
Thank you.